Hi, this is Reverb Audio, and today this is a very special video. I am celebrating the memory of my mentor, Stu Ono. And this is a CJ preamp, PV12. This used to be one of the flagship preamps of Conrad Johnson. And this was a unit that my mentor, he sold it to my friend. And he did not just sell things as he did, but everything that he sold in his store was modified, and usually heavily modified. And in the case of this unit, I just got it back from my friend, and I'm going to do a recap job on it. Well, I don't call it a job because it's not a job. It's truly something that I do for my friend. And I was thinking that I will show what Stu did to this CJ, why he did it, and let's just celebrate his legacy, because I don't think that there's any videos on YouTube showing what he did, and probably there won't be too many opportunities for this. I don't think so. So removing the cover, first of all, what we see inside, this is a unit that literally is packed full with film capacitors, and there's rarely any electrolytics in there, and that's just for the filament supply for the DC, but that's it. Everything else is film capacitors, and you might see, or you might notice if you know how a PV12 looks on the inside, that this unit has way more film caps than the standard PV12, and you might notice that these yellow caps are something that you do not see on a regular CJ. And so here, if you look at that, that's the high voltage filters section, and there Stu added the first bypass cap. And let me just show them closely. It's a Southern Electronics capacitor, and this was not something that you could buy anywhere, because these were the caps that Stu has designed and Stu has made by the company Southern Electronics. So it's a Californian capacitor making company, and a lot of high-end audio companies use Southern Electronics to make capacitors, make their own capacitors, and then they put their own labels on them, and it looks like you have brought a capacitor that was made by that company, and in reality the maker of that capacitor was Southern Electronics, and Southern Electronics made a lot of the audio capacitors. And these were Stu's designs, so they were metallized polypropylene capacitors, as you see, like the, where is that, MPEX-2, so that designates the metallized polypropylene designation. And Stu did not go to have his name on the cap, so he was fine with the Southern Electronics on it. So it's a 1.5 microfarad 600 volt rated plastic cap. And what differentiates this Southern Electronic cap from most other capacitors that high-end audio companies make is that you see they are flattened. So, and then Stu told me that they do not wind them flat, but basically the process was that they made the cap like a round cap, and then they used pressure and just flattened them down at the end of the manufacturing process. So that's how, if you see a flattened capacitor, that's how they become flattened, that at the end they just squeeze them down. And why is that? That's because you know that capacitance is basically a phenomenon that occurs between two parallel plates, right? And inductance is something that happens when you have a coil. Now look at that. When we have those round capacitors, basically we have two plates which are coiled up, so there's a lot of inductive properties working on, and the capacitance is has it's a little bit tricky because it's not flat surfaces but a spiral, it's a coil, and when you flatten it out, even though it's still a spiral, but at least the parallel surfaces here are like these tiny points, and that's it, and then it curves. At least if it's flattened out, then you have like here, so you have the curved parts only here at the sides, but here that part and that part on the bottom, so these parts are parallel surfaces. So when you have a flat or a flattened capacitor, it acts much more like a true capacitor compared to these round ones, which are quite far from the ideal capacitor. So basically, these yellow ones were Stu's first generation capacitor, and the white body ones were Stu's second generation caps. And actually what he did is when you get an order from Southern Electronics, you cannot just get like one capacitor or 10, not even 100. The smallest order he had to put in was for 3,000 capacitors, and that cost him $10,000. And because of that, he could do what he did to this amp. That's to literally pepper them with these very high quality capacitors, and he charged his customers much less than he would have if he just had bought the pre-made audiophile capacitors that other companies had made also by Southern Electronics. So he just went ahead and he fronted that huge amount of cash. And then basically for several decades, he had enough stash of capacitors to use on people's amps and preamps and units and DACs, phono stages. So basically, when you look at the SCR caps, these are also film capacitors. These are like 20 microfarads, 13.5, 4 microfarads. And Stu used these 1.5 microfarads higher quality bypasses to basically to speed them up. And you see these caps are all on these bigger film caps have these bypass caps. And when he had the coupling caps, he just took out the original CJs and put these higher quality coupling capacitors instead. So I would say this is the upper side of the preamp. Now let's flip it over and let's look at what he did at the bottom. And look, the bottom is also littered with even more capacitors. You see he has those 600 volt rated caps as bypass capacitors everywhere. And he also has, look at these tinier ones, so it looks like this, but much smaller. So this is also 1.5 microfarad, but rated at 150 watts. So Stu also had these made for, and these are for the filament supplies, for low voltages. And he basically, even though there are electrolytic capacitors, because you need to use them, there are no film capacitors that are big enough in value for a filament supply, but you can use film capacitors to bypass it. And so here we are, that's what I'm talking about. So for the filament supply, you have the electrolytic capacitor and it's bypassed by the film capacitor. And where he could, he put the bigger ones, but the small ones are much cheaper. They cost much cheaper to make, and he can put it into places where the big one would not fit. And now this is moving, but he had these stuck to there by using a little bit of glue or goo, and because it's not a good idea to have these things resonate. So if they are flat against the surface and they don't have the chance to resonate, then that will not get transferred into the sound. Also here, you see those two are bi-bi units, and those were designed and made by Jack Bybee, and Stu was the person who had the most experience with the Bybee units. I would say he know about their application more than Jack Bybee himself, and that's because he experimented a lot with it. So Jack Bybee was the one who found out this technology, what it does, and basically I cannot really say how he developed it and under what circumstances. He told me that in confidence, but I am, even though he passed away, but I don't think it would be fair to him to reveal that in public. And but what I can say about it is that Bybee units correct the phase of the electricity they pass, so the voltage and the current, if there is a phase differential between them, they help to rectify that phase difference, and that's why they are best used if directly in front of a transformer or after a transformer. So whenever you are using Bybees, then always put them close to an inductive device, and that's where they will do their job. If you put it somewhere else, then you are probably just wasting your money or just doing something which will not be helpful for the sound, and then you can curse that these Bybees don't work. But it's not the Bybees, it's the knowledge. It's kind of like the same thing that when you have a car part, if you install it at the proper pace, it does its job. If you don't know what to do with it, and let's say you have a spark plug and you put it in your trunk, of course your engine won't start. So what else? There's like tons more that Stu did to this unit. You can see that this thing is wired with that oval Kimber copper wire, and those wires run everywhere. It's pretty crazy. And that's because the main weakness of circuit boards is the circuit board itself. You see they have those traces running, and the traces are much poorer quality conductors than a drawn copper wire. And that's one way, a very good way to spruce up, to spice up your PCB unit, just to direct wire those connections and bypass all those junk quality trace and just use a high quality conductor. So let's go back to the upper side, and as you can see here, he did the same thing. He changed the wires which are connecting the RCA jacks to the circuit board. There you see they are running straight. And what else? So for the tubes, you see there are these tube coolers, and people have been using them. That's not news, but what might be news is that he put these soft plastic rings that are normal, that are used on vacuum tubes, so you can use them like those tube cock rings that like these ones. So basically you put them on the tube, and that I kind of can't do it with one hand. I will need two hands, so I have to put down the camera to put it back. But it's there so that when you tap the glass, there's a resonance, right? And if you tap it, you see, it's pretty loud. And that one, it's much, much dampened. So that's what this thing is, that ring is doing. It cuts down on the tube microphonics, and this version, it does the same thing, but it's just made of this soft plastic. And if you are using it especially on a power tube, then the heat just bakes it, and after a while it will just be very rigid and crackling and then just start dropping down. However, in this case, you see it's not even touching the tube, it's really sitting on top of the cooler fin. And because when you add this fin, what it does, it conducts the heat away from the tube, so helps it with a longer life, but also it adds a metallic resonance to the tube, and this plastic helps to dampen that mechanical resonance. And there's one more thing that's to do with it. So this cooler is actually pure copper, which is anodized copper, so it looks black. And Stu connected a copper wire, and that wire is grounded. So basically it's acting as a shield. So all of these tubes are shielded, but it's not like that hard shield that you see on some older amps, especially on some radios, where you have those metal covers that are encasing the tube, and that really shields the tube from all sorts of noise. That's really fantastic. You get the shielding effect, but with such a shield, there's also comes the capacitive effect, and it cuts down on the high frequencies quite noticeably for audio application. But these things, because the copper is just not like a continuous surface, but is just like so you see the fins, and the inside looks like that, as maybe you can see it from here. So it's not a single straight piece of metal surface covering the tube, just it's touching at points. So it does not have as bad detrimental effect to the tube's response as a continuous metal surface would. And just a few things, maybe you can see how part of why this CJ was so expensive back then is, look at the tube sockets. So it's not a hard tube socket, but it's using these special sockets. Actually, I don't know if it came with, I think it came with those, but if not, then Stu changed the sockets to these sockets. If you are wondering, these are the best tube sockets that you can get. Why? Because these are dampened and they are not directly mechanically connected to the chassis. So when I'm subjecting it to vibration, then the tubes do not get that vibration, because there is also a piece of soft plastic underneath, and that's absorbing all the vibrations and keeping those tubes basically floating and not attached to the chassis in a hard mechanical way. And you also see the nice Alps volume pot and the selector switches. You see when you select, the knob is here, and then there's a shaft going back to the back, so when you select inputs, they are the inputs are not running across the entire preamp and then go to the tubes, but they are selected right here, and then there's just one pair of wires, the output that goes to the circuitry, and that's something very important. And you see this in every single high level preamp. You don't see the wires crisscrossing up here to the selector switch and then going back. What else? So basically that's it. One more thing is that all of the CJ preamps, like if we think about the PV5, which was the smaller or like intermediate level unit, which was like a ridiculously good preamp, and I would say the only preamp that I would have recommended to anyone, and with the Stu's mods of course, that was a killer preamp for the price. This preamp was an absolutely fantastic preamp, but the problem here, especially here in Hawaii, is time. So this unit is over 15 years old, I think about 20 years old shortly, And it's only because my friend has kept extremely good care of it. That's why the circuit board and the inside looks so beautiful, so pristine. I tried to resurrect five PV5 units, and none of them could have been resurrected, and that was 5 years ago. So time is not kind to circuit boards here in Hawaii, and we have a rare opportunity here to see a preamp, to see a CJ from that era, from the 2000s, which is still in a fantastic shape, and it's Stu's legacy. And thank you everyone for looking, and this is for Stu's memory. One more thing, you see this, those things there, and those things, these are some blue tech and a quartz crystal attached to it. And what on earth is that doing there? This is not voodoo, this is not new age. Quartz is piezoelectric. So what that means is that when you subject quartz into an electric field, then it will absorb the electromagnetic field and transform it into mechanical resonance, into vibration. So it will do two things. It will prevent the electromagnetic field of this capacitor to radiate out in the chassis, but it will do the opposite as well. So whatever electromagnetic fields are generated by the other components, that crystal is going to absorb part of it and prevent the capacitor from absorbing that electromagnetic pollution, basically. And you might think, well, whatever, but this is actually really huge. And if you have solid state equipment, then just pasting a piece of crystal with blue tack on each of your capacitors, even electrolytic capacitors, will make a tremendous difference towards making that solid state gear sound much more tube-like. And the blue tack is a crucial component of it, so you cannot just hard glue a crystal onto the surface, because the electromagnetic field will make the crystal vibrate, and you need the blue tack, because the blue tack is a pliable plastic. It's like chewing gum that never hardens, and basically it's going to absorb that minute mechanical resonance that the crystal is transmitting. So thank you everyone for tuning in, and just so for everyone to make a scope of what is that I'm going to face here. So that's the amount of parts that will be required to do this recap job. Is just absolutely monstrous. It's like almost 2 kilograms of parts, and it's literally hundreds of pieces. So that will be a fun thing to do, and I wanted to film to have Stu's, one of Stu's last babies, on just here for the eternity, that we can see what he has done before I'm going to recap it, and then we won't see Stu's caps anymore. And sadly, I have to do this recap job because of this. So when you look, maybe I use a pointer there, when you see that those markings there, those lines that you see in the center, maybe let's just look somewhere where we can see it better. You see that discoloration towards the center. So that discoloration is because when the leads were attached, when they were soldered to the film inside the capacitor, that connection, it started to corrode. And that corrosion is showing up here like that. And that's why I have to remove every single one of these capacitors. Sadly, that's because of a defect in the manufacturing process. And I had a couple of units from Stu, and they all show that aging process, and none of these capacitors. So if you still have these in your amp,
then unfortunately you have to change all of them because they have expired. And if you want to hold on to them, what you will notice is that you will hear pretty nasty noises, sometimes creeping up, even if nothing is playing, and you see hear a whooshing sound and then dischargings. That's because the capacitors are failing. And sadly, the same thing is happening with the white units, and there you can sometimes see it as that yellow discoloration there or there at the center. And yeah, but these were the last generation that Stu made, couple years later than the yellow units. And yep, so these the yellow units gave up the ghost about almost like 8 years ago, and the white ones started giving up the ghost about 5 years or so ago. And some of them still work, but I would say just a few more years and then all of them will be useless. So now I'm not using any of them. And if there is a component with any, I just remove them and then give it back to my friends to keep as a souvenir to remind them of Stu. So thank you everyone. And have a wonderful day. Thank you, Stu. See you on the other side sometime from now.